Robert De Niro is perhaps the leading American actor of his generation. But when it comes to the business of film, he's played a critical supporting role. De Niro and his producing partner, Jane Rosenthal, launched the Tribeca Film Festival in 2002. The annual event has brought hundreds of independent films to wider audiences, fostering a vibrant creative community.
It's becoming part of the fabric of the city, a tradition that'll last forever.
While constantly expanding its artistic horizons.
You're on different screens, but you're still telling these great stories.
I sat down with these two legendary figures on the eve of this year's festival, and we discussed everything from partnerships.
I said, Marty, I think, you know, maybe read this book because I think this is more what we should be doing.
To platforms.
We have to start looking at where the consumer is, where the audiences are.
To politics.
He's debased the presidency, as far as I'm concerned.
That's all coming up in this special Bloomberg Businessweek debrief, a conversation with Robert De Niro and Jane Rosenthal. I began by asking De Niro how he approached the story of Bernie Madoff, who he plays in the upcoming HBO film he produced with Rosenthal, Wizard of Lies.
Well, the one thing I always felt very strongly about was that the kids didn't know anything. And I don't think his wife did either, really. He protected them. I don't see anything that says otherwise. but it was an interesting character. It's been so long ago. I did it almost a year and a half ago.
A master manipulator.
Yeah, and I mean, it's the classic con where he's, you know, everybody comes to him and they want to be part of this club. And that whole thing evolved through his personality, his way of manipulating people, that he became, you know, it's classic. It's a classic sort of con situation that people fell for.
Jane, it wasn't the easiest movie to get made. I think you optioned the book 6 years ago, as long ago. Tell me about a little bit of that process. I've heard you say that had you done it right away, the film would have been different in terms of focusing more on the scheme and the con. And as it evolved, it became more about the family and really a family story of a family breaking apart.
When the book came out, Dan Henrique's book, Wizard of Lies, it would have focused more on the Ponzi scheme. And as we got distance from it, as you know, one son died of cancer, one son hung himself. As you got further away, you realized this broken family. So there was certainly, you know, he hurt a lot. Bernie hurt a lot of people. He was really quite despicable, but he also hurt those he thought he was really protecting, and left them in such a vulnerable position. And there's actually a moment in the film where Mark says, how do I trust anything?
Mark Madoff,
how do I trust anything about myself when the father who raised me, who taught me right from wrong, has lied about everything? And so you think about that, and growing up like that was really made for magnificent drama.
And HBO was your partner as well and helped push to get that through. Obviously, the hope being that when it will get a larger audience than had you gone, say, through a more traditional sort of...
Well, if we had gone through a more traditional, this is not a movie that major studios are making today. It would be considered a smaller movie. So you would be doing this the independent film route, and that is... a lot of work. A lot of, to use an old expression, pushing papers. And this way, HBO came in, and they were Len Amato, who runs HBO Films. He's terrific and really supported the project. And it's the first time Bob and Michelle Pfeiffer have done a project for HBO, and we're really quite proud of it.
Speaking of other sort of non-traditional projects, I'm excited about The Irishman, which is bringing the band back together in some ways with Joe Pesci, you, Al Pacino, about the story about Jimmy Hoffa's disappearance, death.
Right. Hopefully Joe Pesci will be in it. We're
We're not sure if Joe's in it. And so actually, this is the moment that we're going to say, Joe, are you going to do this or not?
Joe, on Bloomberg, you are got to get in this movie. But tell me about, that's obviously going on your long-term partnership with Martin Scorsese.
We were involved in another project that we were going to do, but I read this, I heard you paint houses, and it was out for about 2 years, and I kept wanting to read it. And I said, Marty, I think, you know, maybe read this book, because I think this is more what we should be doing. And we tried at one point to see if we could put the old project and the new thing together, but it was just too complicated. So we pivoted and made the, you know, and took, it's been about 10 years.
It was 10 years ago. We were having a green light call on the other project, and Bob said, well, maybe there's this other project. So we
there went a
go movie, turned into a development deal, turned into here we are 10 years later. But anyway, it's really exciting.
One of the things I think that's particularly fascinating from the business side is that you're going through Netflix for this and that they've put up the money. How disruptive is that now in terms of that kind of model, whether it's Netflix, whether it's Amazon, and going straight to them as opposed to going again through traditional film distribution?
Look, the business is rapidly changing. I think that the audiences, consumers, have more choices than ever, and they're screen agnostic. So it doesn't make a difference whether you, if you do it on Netflix and then you can screen it on a big screen, or you want to watch it on a small screen. I have teenagers. They are watching something at every moment, whether it's their phone, their computer, or a large screen. So consumer behaviors are changing, and as producers, it's really it's wonderful for us, because if we want to make a certain type of film, there's all different venues now to go to. There's all different opportunities for financing. We have to start looking at where the consumer is, where the audiences are. And audiences now have so many different choices. And so even, you have to be able to differentiate the project and what's good for a project and where it belongs and on what platform.
Well, I want to turn to talk about the festival, because it's the 16th year, and just how much it's been a vital, obviously, in cultural rebuilding after 9/11 in New York, but also an economic part of that economic renaissance downtown as well. When you look at it, how has it evolved, Bob, through the years in terms of what are you most proud of when you look at that and what it's become for New York?
Well, I'm proud that it lasted this long and that it's becoming part of the fabric of the city, a tradition that'll last forever, you know. I'm very, very excited, proud, you know, that it's just there.
You think back to that first year we opened the film festival, that first year on the steps of City Hall, with Bob, the mayor, President Clinton, and Nelson Mandela, who basically gave us the permission, if you will, to go watch some movies. You couldn't just go from being a recovery operation to suddenly in Lower Manhattan to screening movies. And Mandela came and sort of blessed the opportunity and said, you know, you've got to celebrate community.
Now, so much of the festival, when I read about it, is about exploring these boundaries of tech, of other things. This year, gaming, for example. I didn't know that you actually produced a video game in 1996 with a cast, if I'm correct, Jim Belushi, Cher, mm-hmm. Ellen DeGeneres, and Steven Tyler in a game called The Last Resort. So yes. it's been a long-term passion of yours, and it's going to be a big part of the festival this year?
Yes. Always have been interested in novelistic storytelling, and even I think the projects that Bob has been attracted to, if you look at something like Good Shepherd and, you know, the length of those stories are more novelistic. So for me, it's different for Bob, but I'm always interested in nonlinear storytelling. And this year at the festival, we have Kujima and Ken Levine, who did Bioshock, and some of the most extraordinary storytellers in gaming. So it's another way, again, to look at how entertainment is changing, how you're on different screens, but you're still telling these great stories. The festival a number of years ago was the first festival to actually screen a game. We screened L.A. Noire, which was from Rockstar, which is a terrific company that's based here in New York.
The arts have been under fire under President Trump. Coming up, Jane Rosenthal and Robert De Niro fire back.
Artists' voices need to be heard loud and proud.
This is not The Apprentice. This is real.
You've been, Bob, quite vocal about some of the political climate that we're living in. You've been quite vocal about Trump. You've called him a bully, a pig, threatened to punch him. Is there anything in this first week's, the first 100 days, which we're coming rapidly up to, that has given you time to pause and think this could be better, this could be worse?
Well, I always try and give any situation that I feel is negative the benefit of the doubt that it'll change, it'll get better. I haven't seen that with him. It's the same situation. It's not. I don't think it will change. He will do certain things like what he did in Syria. I agree with what he should have done. But I don't know where that's going to go. I'm worried that we're going to get into a situation where we have a real confrontation. And in that sense, he might do something and he'll get credit for it, and everybody will think he's a great president or something along those lines. That's my concern. But I think other than that, debased the presidency, as far as I'm concerned.
Well, let's talk about that a little bit. When people talk about debasing the president, and then you see sort of during his presidency, you know, whether it's calling out Meryl Streep, a friend of yours, after which you wrote a letter saying how important it was for everyone's voice to be active. When we see Saturday Night Live with Alec Baldwin playing Trump or Melissa McCarthy playing Spicer, do you think that one of my concerns, having covered Washington as well, is that these lines are blurred now between what people expect from the political class and what they expect from entertainment, sports, et cetera. Are you concerned about this convergence of sort of reality TV show style and political life?
You know, this is not The Apprentice. This is real. And everything he says and does is very, very important and has an impact around the world. It's not a game, and I think he's so narcissistic and so self-centered, he doesn't really, I don't know whether he gets it, or I just don't understand it. I don't understand I don't understand how he became president, so, and I think a lot of us feel that way. It's just, it's mortifying. And not to say that he won't do good things, and I'll be the first to give him credit for that. But so far, you know.
Jane, you've been quite politically active as well. When you look at the environment, and you look at some of the targeted budget cuts that he would make, National Endowment for the Arts, National Endowment for Humanity, PBS, et cetera, what are you telling people in the industry now about their voice going forward? Is it impacting projects, your decisions you're making about what to do?
Artists' voices need to be heard loud and proud and to keep going. And the NEA is such a small amount by comparison to everything else that, you know, the support of the NEA is vital. It's a public, a community where we're judged by we're remembered by our culture. But artists have always made it through in the most difficult times, and artists' voices bring us together. It's in our DNA. It's how we started the film festival, was artists joining together to say that we're still here after a terrorist act on our country. So, you know, we'll persevere.
Is there anything the entertainment industry should do to help reduce partisanship? Or is it always going to be that Hollywood, New York, San Francisco have a or promote more liberal values than the rest, that than large swaths of the country, whether it's rural America?
That's a good question. I mean, I think we as a country represent so many good things to the rest of the world. Not in everything, but many good things, progressive things. I'm sorry that we don't appeal to people in the middle of the country who have their own needs and issues, and rightfully so. But we represent something that's very, very important, and we don't want to go backwards on that stuff. We can't. And I think, if anything, with Trump, so far it's shown that this country, the system, is pushing back on what he's been doing. And so that, in a way, I mean, I used to joke and say he's gonna, if he didn't become president, he would, you know, he'd say, well, I shook it up, and so I should get credit for that. He did shake it up, and I give him credit now. He really did. He shakes it up right now, and we are the system, as I say, is fighting back, pushing back.
Up next, a discussion of disruption, how Netflix and Amazon are changing the distribution game.
The traditional players are also going to have to look hard at their business and start taking some real risks in what they're doing.
And a master's advice for young actors who are breaking into the business.
You go to the auditions, you open calls, even though they've been cast already. You go, you go, you go.
Bob, I went back and watched a graduation address you gave at Tisch 2 years ago to that class. And it went viral because you had said at the very beginning something I can't say on TV, like, congratulations, you've made it. And now, to paraphrase, you don't have a great outlook for it. But the thing that really stood out for me in that talk was how much you talked about failure and rejection and the struggle. And you've talked a lot about how you're where you are because you're lucky.
Mm-hmm.
But how much is lucky combined with going through that struggle of rejection and pushing through?
It's, well, lucky, luck is there, but you have to be ready to be in a position to get lucky. And that means you have to consistently be doing what you have to do, and because you love doing it, and you just can't give up. You gotta keep going to all the auditions, as I did. You go to the auditions, the open calls, even though they've been cast already. You go, you go, you go. For example, if you see a casting director and just go and assume you're not gonna get the part, and you won't get the part, most likely. But the casting director, who's more important than the director in some ways, because they work with a lot of directors, they'll remember you and say, this person wasn't quite right for what you're thinking, isn't quite, but you should meet them because they're interesting and they did an interesting thing that I've seen, blah, blah, blah. So in that sense, and that means you have to just go out there and keep moving forward. You can't give up.
When did you realize that you were good?
Oh, I don't even know if I'm good now. I mean, I just do what I'm doing.
But even as producers, you know, it's, you're being told no all the time. We were just talking about The Irishman, or you were talking about Wizard of Lies. Those projects took a long time. It's where still, you know, knock on wood, talk about being lucky, you know, hoping Irishman, it goes 100%. I mean, even as we sit here.
Even like, at your level, even with both of you, and the work that goes in to
it
get.
It is, when he says you gotta keep, you know, I mean, it's every day. It's like, what are we gonna do? A lot of times it's like Sisyphus pushing a rock up a hill. You get told.
That's what journalism is like.
But you get told in this business no more than you get told yes, no matter where, what vaulted position you think you know, somebody perceives you as being in. You get told no more than yes.
What do you think is the thing that we may not be seeing in terms of that's the next disruption to entertainment, or the next thing, the next way of distribution, the next, as you said, the way consumption are bringing stuff to the audience in a different way? Is it virtual reality? Is it, what's the next big thing?
Well, what is the next? Virtual reality is still so new. And until the actual headsets get to be a bit more practical and completely affordable beyond just the cardboard, it's going to take a while. Certainly for journalism and documentary films, VR is wonderful because you can walk in the shoes of somebody, and it's so empathetic. I do think that where gaming is going in so many ways, both as from a business standpoint of esports and how that is really taking up will be a huge business. It certainly is already with League of Legends and some of the other smaller games. In terms of storytelling, you're seeing creatives play on all different platforms. So I'm not giving you that one simple answer. VR might be it, but it's not necessarily just VR. It will probably be more mixed reality, and how you use it might not be what you think you're going to use it for. So it might really be more for education, for travel, for an aging population versus just entertainment.
On that note, in terms of what's changing, what do you have left that you want to do? What do you have left in terms of roles, in terms of your legacy, in terms of what you want to do with the festival? What's on your bucket list?
Well, with the festival, we don't know. It's constantly changing. So it'll be what it'll be, and we just have to hopefully be ahead of the curve and part of it and roll with it. I'm doing The Irish with Marty, which I'm looking forward to. And then I'm doing a thing with David O. Russell for two seasons at this point, which I am also looking forward to. It's sort of a family saga.
A TV series?
Yeah, it's for Amazon. And I'm going to be pretty
again
busy.
Bringing the band back together.
But when you talk about that, it's years ago, even 10 years ago, you wouldn't have somebody like Bob or Meryl crossing back and forth between film, TV. Now people do it with ease. There were definitely real dividing lines in town, in Hollywood. You didn't even eat in the same restaurants.
Tell me, exactly on that sort of metamorphosis, is Netflix now, is the Amazon the place where you go to take these big risks, that you can afford to get the backing and the freedom to do these kind of projects?
They're certainly taking the risks right now, and I think that the traditional players are also going to have to look hard at their business and start taking some real risks in what they're doing. As long as certain networks are getting the audiences they want and are happy with that, that's one thing. You look at how the advertising industry has changed and sort of the death of the 30-second and 60-second spot, and everybody now wants to do branded content, and you have ad blockers. I mean, the business has just changed so much. So for for creatives, we have all different opportunities. That's what this new distribution pattern has allowed us to be able to do.
Well, we certainly live in fascinating times. I want to thank you guys so much for stopping by to talk to us, and I'm sure that, and the festival will be a triumph as always. Bob, Jane, thanks so much for
having
us. Thank you.
Business Week.